All right. Good evening, everyone. I would like to welcome you to tonight's presentation by Mr. Laban. I think from the discussion we had last week, we felt like we could expand more on the presentation made by Trinus by now going, you know, like into the nitty-gritties and dealing with the finer details. So we'll start this presentation tonight with Laban looking at the evaluation of portal hypertension using ultrasound. We'll keep our microphones on mute until the end of the presentation, at which we'll be free to unmute our microphones to make contributions, to ask questions, or ask, even to thank Mr. Laban for a wonderful presentation, of which I believe it's going to be one. So to everyone, wherever you are joining us from, I would like to welcome you to this wonderful evening. I think the success of these meetings is dependent on your participation by tuning into this channel. And please do take time to visit our YouTube channel, which is Radiology Without Borders, where all these presentations are uploaded every evening when network does not fail us. At this point, kindly allow me to let Mr. Laban get to the floor and then share with us the good stuff that is prepared. Mr. Laban, it's all yours. Thank you, sir.
Thank you so much for the introduction. I just want to confirm if my slides are visible and if everyone is hearing me. If so,
kindly share the content. Your slides are not yet visible.
Okay. Are we there?
Yes, we are. Those of you that have just joined us, can you just quickly mute your microphones? Mr. Laban is about to start the presentation, just to make things easy. You can start, Laban.
All right. So, as the introduction has been given, my name is Laban. So we are looking at ultrasound evaluation of portal hypertension. So we are going to start our presentation. So this is just a disclaimer that those cases or the pictures which are shared were not done by me, but a collection from different literature. So our objective for today, we are going to define portal hypertension. New portal circulation system. And we are going to give an overview of the pathophysiology of portal hypertension, and we'll state the technical factors, describe the sonographic features also. And then there are some few images that we are going to look at later on. So we are going to start by the definition. Portal hypertension is defined as a common syndrome, which is characterized by a chronic increase in the portal venous pressure. So this is the increase in pressure gradient between the portal vein and the IVC exceeding 5 mm Hg. We'll look at just a brief overview on portal circulation. So this is part of the systemic circulation, which drains the capillary bed of the GIT pancreas and liver, and also other parts like the gallbladder. Then the portal circulation delivers about 75% of liver's blood, which is both oxygenated and partially oxygenated, and it is also rich in nutrients.
Laban, Could you unmute your microphone? I've muted you because people had kept their mics on. Laban, you can unmute your microphone. All Laban? Right.
Yes?
Yeah. Yes, you can proceed. I had to mute everyone else. You can proceed.
All right. So we are looking at the diagram, which is showing us the proper circulation. As we know, there are two major types of circulation in the body. We have the pulmonary circulation and the systemic circulation. So the portal circulation is part of the systemic circulation. And in here, we have the liver, which is there, and then the ascending colon. We have the small intestine. We have the descending colon here. We have the stomach, the duodenum, the pancreas. We have the spleen there. So these ones are the organs which are involved in the portal circulation. So we have this where the pointer is there, that is the superior mesenteric vein, which drains the part of the small intestine, the ascending part. And then we have the inferior mesenteric vein, which drains the descending part of the colon. Then we have the stomach here, and we have the coronary veins, which then the stomach up to the esophagus there, and then we have the splenic vein, which also drains the spleen, and all these come to pour the contents in the portal vein, and then the portal vein enters the liver on the portal hilum. And then from there, the blood is carried to the inferior vena cava through the hepatic veins. And then from the inferior vena cava, we all know the blood will go to the right atrium. So that is just a brief description of what is involved in the portal circulation. So as we were saying, we have blood passing through the sinusoids, which are in the liver. And in those sinusoids, we have cavities between the hepatocytes of the liver. And then we have a collection into the central veins, and then when the blood is collected, it enters into the central vein, and then it empties in the hepatic vein, and from the hepatic vein it goes to the IVC, as we described earlier on the diagram. So this is just a simple illustration of what the sinusoid is, where the blood from the portal vein is going to pass. So we have the portal triad here. We have the portal vein, then we have the hepatic artery. We have the hepatic artery, the bile duct, and the portal vein. So those are the three major ones, although we also have the lymphatic duct here, but we won't talk about this. So our concentration is on the blood, which is coming from the portal vein. The blood passes through these spaces, called these are the sinusoids, where blood from the portal vein is going to pass. And then here we have these cells, we have the Kaffer cells, and then the hepatocyte cells there. As the blood moves, a lot of activities are going to happen there, but that's not our concern for today. Then this blood is drained into the central vein, which is later drained into the hepatic veins. So this is just a brief description of how the blood moves from the portal vein up to where it ends into the hepatic vein. So we know the blood in the portal vein flows towards the liver. The medical term used there is the hepatopetal flow. The opposite term to that is hepatofugo. So when you are describing the flow in the portal vein, we describe it as hepatofetal when it is flowing towards the liver, and hepatofugo if there is reverse flow. So the Doppler flow of the both of them is relatively constant. And then it has dampening due to the splanchnic parenchyma and the capillary gut and the liver sinusoid. So the dampening we are talking about here is that we know that blood comes from the arterial system, which is from the heart. We know in the arteries, blood will be pulsating. But then in the portal vein, we have this dampening of the pulsations due to the blood which passed through the spleen, the capillary gut, and then as it passes through the portal vein, we find that there is dampening of those waves there. So we also find that the velocity of blood which is passing through the portal vein is about 10 to 25 centimeters per second in a fasting state. In a non-fasting state, the blood is relatively faster. So we normally examine the portal vein in a fasting state. And then we also have a bit of physicity on the portal vein floor. Since we from the first part there, we are saying there's dampening of the waves. It's not completely flat, but then there's physicity, which is as a result of respiration and the lift of the flow in the hepatic vein, and also the pulsation from the hepatic artery system pressure. So an overview of the pathophysiology, how does portal hypertension start? So portal hypertension, it starts when there's increased vascular resistance to the portal blood flow, in the, which is the initial factor. So just the increase in resistance is where things start to happen. So when there's that increased resistance, we understand there's going to be elevated portal pressure. And when the portal pressure is elevated, it will lead to formation of extensive network of portal systemic collaterals. As we know how the body works, when there's resistance to blood flow, we know because of the anastomosis, which is there in different areas, we find that because of that increased pressure, there will be opening of those channels so that the blood can be diverted to other, to other veins, which is going to allow that blood to get back to the systemic circulation. So a large fraction of this blood bypasses the liver through these collaterals which are formed. So that is the response of how the body will respond to that increased pressure. So on a general scale, portal hypertension may be caused by three factors or three categories. So we have the pre-sinusoidal, and we also have the sinusoidal and the post-sinusoidal causes. So as you remember, the sinusoid we are talking about is those spaces where blood from the portal vein passes while it is in the liver for it to cross the hepatic vein. So on the pre-sinusoidal, we have portal vein thrombosis as one of the causes. We have schistosomiasis there as another cause. There are also other causes, but we are just touching on a few. Then on a sinusoidal, which is in the liver itself, we have cirrhosis, we have amyloidosis, and sinusoidal infiltration with tumors and others that we are not mentioning. Then the post-sinusoidal causes, we have CHF, which is the cardiac failure there, and pericardial disease, also bad chiari, which is the blockage of the hepatic vein. So these are, it's just a group on how the causes are categorized. We are also going to look at the technical factors for us to evaluate the portal system. We have to have certain technical factors that will allow us to do that efficiently. So we are going to need an ultrasound machine with a probe, which has a frequency of about 2 to 5 megahertz. 2 because we need penetration, and 5, we need quality pictures or images for us to evaluate the photo system. Then we need our patient to be in a fasting state. As we stated, after a patient eats, we are going to have increase in velocity and other effects that may change our parameters. So we need the patient to be in a fasting state. Grayscale, obviously, every machine will have the grayscale there. And then we also need harmonic imaging. This harmonic imaging, as we all know, it helps to improve the quality of the image by doubling the frequencies that we examine. Of course, small machines may not have such kind of capabilities, but it's better if we use an equipment which has such capabilities so that we can see the small vessels. We also need a machine which will make our images better by having this spatial compounding capacity. And then also we have Doppler capabilities. So from here we can tell that you really need a good machine for you to examine the photo circulation efficiently. So on the vessels that are supposed to be sampled, we have the proximal aorta, the main right and left hepatic arteries, the main photo vein, right and left, the splenic vein, the superior mesenteric vein, the hepatic vein, and IVC. So we are also going to measure the peak systolic velocity in hepatic arteries, the portal vein, and the abdominal aorta. So here we should measure, at least we should sample the main portal vein and hepatic artery and record the highest peak systolic. That is, you sample three sample areas and get the highest peak systolic velocity there. So this one is just an illustration in children that may have liver disease. These are the sample areas where you can sample when you are evaluating the photocirculation. So this vein here is a superior mesenteric vein. And then from here, we have the photoconfluence. So you can sample before the photoconfluence here. And then you also have the portal vein starts from there. So we are taking a sample here and here on the portal vein. Then this one is the splenic vein. So we are going to sample, to take a sample there and also to take a sample there. This one is the left coronary vein, which is going to the stomach. We also take one sample there. Then while we are in the portal vein, we are taking two samples. Here we are branching. This is the right hepatic vein, the right portal vein. We take a sample there, left portal vein. We take another sample there. And here we have the IVC and the hepatic vein. So we take a sample from each of those. That is in children. So this is just a reference diagram, which you can even put in your department to see as part of your protocol when you are doing the sampling. So on the 2D measurements, we are going to measure the portal vein. So as we know, the patient should be in a supine position, and the portal vein is measured in longitudinal, that is inner to inner, without including the walls. So in a quiet respiration state, we understand that the portal vein should measure about 9 to 13 millimeters in diameter. And in a full inspiration, it can measure even up to 16 millimeters. So this is important because we are going to do these measurements, one in quiet inspiration and the other one we are going to do in full inspiration. And once we do those, we record those, it's going to give certain values or an idea on the behavior or the caliber of the photo vein. The splenic vein should measure less than 10 millimeters. The splenic vein is measured in transverse. Remember the photo vein, the main photo vein we are measuring in longitudinal, splenic vein in transverse. So this one is being measured at the level of the superior mesenteric artery in supine position. The patient is supine. Then the superior mesenteric vein also should measure about less than 10 millimeters. And this one should be in a surge position, close to the confluent. So with these figures, you find that there is a lot of literature which gives, okay, I'm seeing a message. Can you see you can't see the screen. Are you following the screen?
Yes, no, yes, we can see.
All right. Now I was reading a message somebody. Thank you. So we have, yes. So I was at the superior mesenteric vein, which should also measure less than 10. So I was saying in different literature, there are different values that they have given. So these are the ones that I came across, but you can still find other values there. So this is just an image to illustrate the main photo vein. So the main photo vein starting from here, somewhere this side, we have the photo confluence and then going into the liver. This is the liver hierarchy there. So this one, so we are saying this is the main photo vein when you are in almost an oblique subcostal A. So you get this elongated photo vein. Here it is going to branch, going in this direction and that direction, but in this view, you can only see it when you go in transverse, and this is what you are going to find. So when you get to the transverse section of the liver, you have the IVC there, where you have the caudal lobe, and the main photo vein is somewhere here, where it is going to divide into the left photo vein, which is the horizontal part of the left photo vein, and we have the ascending part of the photo vein there, and then we have these medial and lateral branches. This side, the short part here, this is the right photo vein, and then it divides into the anterior and posterior to supply those segments. So that is just an example of the branches, the left and right branches of the main photo vein. And then on the findings, we have the diameter of photo vein increases in initial stage more than 13 millimeters. That is in a quiet inspiration. And then 16 millimeters. Okay, I didn't put the units there. It should be millimeters in deep inspiration. Why is this important? This is important to assess the caliber of the photo vein. Remember, if the photo vein does not increase in deep inspiration for less than 20%, it means the caliber of the portal vein is not there. So you should be able to get around those figures to test how the caliber of the portal vein is. And this has proved to have a sensitivity of 81% and specificity of 100%. When you do those maneuvers. So the other findings that you may find is that there is loss of respiration, variation on the photo vein, and the photo vein becomes flattened when you are doing the spectral wave tracing. With increase in the photo vein, in the photo vein diameter, you will find that since the diameter is big, the velocity is going to decrease. So as you are doing your Doppler testing there, you will find that in photo hypertension, the velocity will decrease. And then as you continue evaluating, in some cases, you find that there's bidirectional flow, meaning that the flow will go forward and backwards, or hepatopetal and hepatopugo at the same time, mean alternatively. So when you do your color doctor, you can see the color changing depending on how the the blood is moving in the portal vein. So there is decrease in portal vein flow. Remember the diameter is big, so the portal vein flow is decreasing, and that's why we have the reduced velocity there. And since there is this reduced flow, then the demand for the liver will still be the same. Now, as a compensatory mechanism, you find that there will be increase in the size of the hepatic artery. This is now why we are going to also take samples in the hepatic artery, because it is one way of compensating flow to the liver. So we have decreased the flow in the portal vein, and then some of the blood now will be channeled to the liver through the hepatic artery, which is going to dilate, and then it will become clotless. So our hepatic artery Doppler there is going to be very helpful to see if there's any compensation of flow of blood. So on the flattening of the hepatic veins there, we know that because of the reduced flow there and the dampening of the waves in the liver, the M-shape, the normal M-shape of hepatic veins is going to flatten a bit because of the loss of elasticity on the liver itself. So one of the most specific features of portal hypertension are the collaterals and the shunts that are going to form. So here, one of the shunts there is the recanalization of the para-umbilical vein and the collaterals that we'll find as we go along. So these are features that will appear as a way of decompressing the flow or reducing the pressure in the portal vein. So these are more or less like a response of the body to those changes. So one of the most important factors we have to bear in mind is the esophageal varices. As we know, in our practice, we'll find that esophageal varices, that is when there is bleeding. And then when bleeding continues, this can cause death, or the outcome is not good. That's why it is very important in portal hypertension to pay attention to locate the esophageal varices, which are located at the EG junction. I think we have an image as we go along on how to locate the EG junction for us to locate these esophageal varices. So the esophageal varices, as we are saying, they are located at the esophageal gastric junction, which we can see in sagittal view. When you place your probe in sagittal view along the aorta, you are going to find that as you go proximally, you are going to see the esophagus where it joins the stomach. Eh? We are going to see it nicely on the image. Or if you don't see that, then you can follow the coronary vein. Remember one of the images there which was showing the coronary vein. This coronary vein, whenever it is more than 4 millimeters and above, then there should be an indication that there is increase in the portal circulation. And then if this coronary vein is dilated more than 7 millimeters, there is very high chance that there will be esophageal bleeding there. So these are the collaterals, some of the collaterals that we find when there is portal hypertension. We have this one at the EG junction, as you can see there. So we have, this is the portal vein there. So you can see there are those small vessels that are going there. So when you have increased pressure there, there will be a lot of increased pressure in these veins, and then you have these collaterals starting to open. So you have there on the gastroesophageal collaterals there, you have this one here at the splenic hilar, You also have from the splenic aorta, there's a connection there to the left renal vein. And then here, you have here at the hemorrhoids on the inferior mesenteric artery. So this side, we have this as a collateral here. This is the paraumbilical vein, which will canalize if there's increased pressure there. So the blood will be diverted to all these collaterals so that blood can re-enter the systemic circulation. So on the some of the things we are just describing now. So we have the paraumbilical vein, which is found in the ligamentum teres or the round ligament. So this one, it veins into the inferior epigastric vein. That is when there is a, when it is open, it will drain into that epigastric vein. So sometimes our paraumbilical vein is going to be open, but it is considered abnormal only when it is more than 3 millimeters and if the flow is extending beyond the liver capsule. And also when you do your Doppler, if the velocity flow there is more than 5 centimeters per second, then we'll consider that as an abnormal finding on the paraumbilical vein. We have talked about the splenorenal shunt, which is the connection between the splenic and the left renal vein. So these ones will show as tortuous veins on the splenic fibre. And then we have here the renal vein, which will dilate. Remember, there's that connection there. So when there's increased pressure there, we have the renal vein dilating plus the reverse flow in the main portal vein. And then also we have cavernous transformation of the portal vein. This is simply when the portal vein is blocked. Remember the causes of portal hypertension there. There was one which was the presinusoidal, where there's blockage or thrombosis on the main portal vein. So when it is in a chronic stage there, so you have the small vessels that are around the main portal vein opening up, which is called cavernous transformation of the portal vein. So you have them opening up and they are seen as multiple serpiginous tortuous periportal collaterals, which you expect to find them along the portal vein area there. So these ones will be, there will be flow, which will be going towards the liver. Remember, it is a mechanism to decompress the pressure which is in the portal vein, and hence these collaterals, they will be flowing towards the liver. So the collaterals there are hepatopetal. And then on Doppler, they have the portal vein waveform. So some of the associated features, but they are not specific to, let me just get a glass of water. All right, so the associated features, we have splenomegaly when the spleen is more than 13 centimeters. Remember, these are not specific, but they might be associated to portal hypertension, but they can be also in isolation. We have ascites, liver cirrhosis, volume distribution, that is the ratios between the right part of the liver and the caudate lobe. So these are part of the findings that you get there. So now on the images, we have our first image here, which is the internalization of the paraumbilical vein. So you see this one, when this one is closed, you will just see an echogenic structure there, which is the ligamentum teres, as it passes from the ascending part of the left portal vein, just in the middle there. That's where this one is attached. But in this state, it is open. And when you put Doppler here, you find that on color flow, blood will be flowing from here, going this direction. And then we have some ascites there as one of the findings. Then here we have the splenic vein near the portal confluence here. Remember, we are talking about the coronary vein. So we have this coronary vein here, which can dilate when there's a portal hypertension. So we said when it is exceeding 4 millimeters, then that one is considered as a sign for portal hypertension. The more images there, this is an example of the splenic hyoid varices. This is the spleen, and when you put your doctor there, you see corpus structures there, as you can see here. Because when there are no these corpus structures, you just see the splenic vein from there, draining the spleen. So you won't see these structures around there. And here we are at the liver hilum. This is where the main portal vein would like to pass, but in this case, we are seeing on Doppler, there are these structures there, which are tortuous. When you put your Doppler there, without Doppler, you just see a lot of cystic structures around there. So this is the cavernous transformation. And then here, this is just an illustration of the spectral Doppler flow in the main portal vein. So we have the normal flow here. So it's supposed to be a bit wavy like that and almost constant. This is the baseline of your settings on the machine. So we have this blood is flowing in one direction like that. This is the real image that you get. Take note of this color bar here, because you might confuse this one here, this normal flow here, and the abnormal flow. So on the color bar, we know this one is representing the flow towards the probe. This one is away from the probe. So when you take note of these color bars here, remember this one, the red is up, this one is also up. So it means this one is in reverse flow. So don't confuse the reverse here and the normal by not taking note of the color bars there, how they're indicating. So this one is the to and fro, where the flow is going forward and backwards. So remember, this image was frozen at a time when flow was going towards the top. But you can also freeze this image at the time when the flow is going downwards, and it will show a different color. So also take note of that when you are freezing the image and indicate what you want to demonstrate. So this is the image I was talking about for locating the EG junction. This is the sagittal view. When you place your probe in the midline, you have, this is the aorta. And along this aorta here, we have the celiac trunk, which is this one here as the first branch. In the second branch, we have the superior mesenteric artery there. So superior here, this is the left pass of the diaphragm. And from here, we can see this is the EG junction. So we are in sagittal, we are cutting this across. So there's an esophagus coming from somewhere this side, and then almost crossing there to connect with the stomach. So if you get this view where there are varices, you can still see varices here. And those varices are going to appear as tortuous structures. If you put your Doppler there, you see a lot of lightening up there. You can also use this same image. This is still in sagittal view. Remember about the coronary vein. So you have this one here is the portal confluence. So as you move your probe still in sagittal, you can still see this is the coronary vein. And when you measure and it's above 4 millimeters, to consider that as a sign for portal hypertension. This is still part of the stomach, the hip junction. There is just the angle which has changed there, but it's still in the same plane. So these are the references, if you want some of the references. Sorry. Yes. And that's the end of the short presentation. So I'm going to allow the host to take over.
Thank you so much, Laban, for that detailed presentation on portal hypertension. At this point, I'll open it up to everyone listening in. If you have any question, contribution, even just to thank Mr. Laban for this presentation, you may go ahead. You can unmute your mic and then ask your question. Any questions? Hello, you can unmute your microphone and then ask a question. Okay, any questions? I can hear a dog back. I'm hoping it's not a question. Any questions?
David?
Yes, sir, Mr. Kua, you may go ahead.
Thank you for the opportunity. Thank you, Laban, for the lessons that we are learning every day, every time we meet. And it really sharpens our skills day by day. I just wanted to point out something that we talked about last time we met. There was this Bakhtiari syndrome. I don't know how it should present itself in connection with portal hypertension. And also, there was somebody also who brought in a Doppler presenting thrombus in the portal vein. I don't know how the Bakhtiari would assimilate itself to our talk. Maybe I missed something. Maybe I missed something. I may have gone. I may have switched off when the presentation was going on.
Mr. Laban, may you elaborate more on that?
All right. Thank you, Mr. Ikua, for the question. So I don't know if you can still see the slide, eh?
Yes, I can see.
The causes of some of the causes for portal hypertension. Remember, we are saying the causes can be suicidal, post-suicidal, or suicidal.
Yeah.
So Bakhtiari, that is when there's the blockage of the hepatic veins. We know the hepatic veins are the ones which are draining the liver.
Yes.
Draining to the IVC. So once those veins are blocked, it means there will be no drainage for the liver. And then if there's no drainage for the liver, it means whatever blood is coming to the liver, there will be increase in pressure there. So that increased pressure, once it is prolonged, you find that the patient might develop portal hypertension because of there's no drainage where the liver is supposed to breathe from. So it's more or less like something that is forward blocking drainage behind. So once that blockage is there, then you have the liver mechanism changing where there will be fibrosis formation and increase of pressure in the liver, and then hence portal hypertension there. That's where the bad theory is coming from. And then on the, you also asked about the thrombus, isn't it?
Yes,
he did.
Yeah, the thrombus also, as we can see here, is a pre-suicidal cause, where if there's a blockage before the liver there, the liver is not going to receive the nutrients or the blood that it needs. So because of that, we are going to have collateral formation in other structures, meaning there's something that is blocking the blood from going forward, and then hence the cause of portal hypertension there, according to the category that we got. So this one is one of the causes that hypertension. I don't know if there's anyone else who would add on to that.
Will that mean that a liver which is starved will have maybe to react in a certain way that maybe even reduces the size, isn't it? Because it's not getting enough nutrients. So we expect the liver maybe to be a bit smaller than normal.
Just to try there, others can contribute as well. So we know if the cells are not getting enough oxygen or enough nutrients, what happens to the cells? They die off. And once those cells die off, scientifically we are calling that as the cell death. So in the liver specifically, you're going to the fibrosis formation. And that fibrosis formation is going to make the liver stiff, and then it will lose that elasticity. And once it goes into that stage, that is now the cirrhosis part of the liver. The liver is rotted because there are a lot of cells which have died there. And because of that, also elasticity. Also, some of those causes for hypertension.
The picture is formed. Thank you so much.
I don't know, there's someone's mic that is really a bit on the noisy side. I don't know if you could mute. Are there any other questions? Any comments from the audience? Okay.
Just a comment. This is Kuda.
Yes, please. Yes, go ahead.
I just wanted to say thank you, Laban. This was just a presentation. I really enjoyed it. I learned something.
All right, thank you for that.